2 o'clock, Martin Ballard is going to be on your radios with his final show on BBC Radio Leicester.
Got a treat in store as well.
I know you have. Come on then, tell me what you've got coming up.
Well, I'll tell you, I'm really looking forward. I haven't spoken to him for a while. In fact, he's not recorded anything for 8 years. Nick Kershaw is my guest a little bit later on. All the hits from the 1980s and more. But he's got a brand new album out, so I'm going to be talking to him. His guest this afternoon stormed the charts and shot to fame after signing with MCA Records back in 1983 and releasing his debut album, Human Racing. Yeah, string of global hits. Wouldn't It Be Good, The Riddle, I Won't Let the Sun Go Down on Me, helping to propel him to 62 weeks on the UK singles chart before performing at Live Aid, of course. After stepping out of the limelight to concentrate on writing and producing, he wrote Chesney Hawkes, The One and Only, and has since collaborated with the likes of Elton John, Sia and Gary Barlow, amongst others. Yeah, he is, of course, Nick Kershaw. We'll speak to him after this. Earlier this year, Nick released an EP of 6 new songs, These Little Things, and now Oxymoron is the latest studio album. It's out this month and it features 16 brand new songs recorded at Abbey Road Studios, including that, She Gets Me. And Nick Kershaw, welcome back to Leicester. How are you?
I'm good, thanks, Martin. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Listen, we had a message on social media from one of our listeners called Joe, who said that back in the day, she remembers that you were her very first concert, and it was December 1984, she thinks. She says that they queued up straight after school just so they could get to the front, and she sobbed and screamed all the way through, and she was 13 years old. How's that make you feel?
Well, even older, probably. Well, those are the days, eh?
They were crazy days, weren't they? I mean, your rise, quite rightly, because the albums were fantastic, but it was a meteoric rise for you, really, wasn't it?
It was pretty mental, yeah. It was, I think the first hit was in January 1984, and then it just went nuts from there. It was pretty much, as they say, overnight. Yeah, it was. Although there was a lot of work that went on before that, obviously.
Of course. I saw you a couple of times here in Leicester at the De Montfort Hall in the 80s, and at least on one of those, I think you had an incredible sort of scaffolding set. You did a lot of climbing around that during the concert, but you obviously loved the live stuff, and you've not, even though you haven't recorded for a while, you've not stopped doing live stuff ever, have you?
Well, I did for about 10 years. Yeah, I stopped doing it in the 90s when I was producing and writing for other people. Well, I kind of got back on the horse sort of late 90s, early 2000s, really.
In terms of the early days, you know, did it catch you by surprise? You said a lot of work had to go into it before, you know, the singles and the albums started to hit the charts. But did the success catch you by surprise?
Not really. I mean, you're surrounded by people who are telling you that you're the greatest thing since sliced bread, and there's all this money being thrown at you, and all this attention being thrown at you, and you just kind of, you kind of believe that it's going to happen. I think you have to have that self-belief. And it did. And it wasn't until you look back on it and you realize that there were so many other people in exactly the same position that I was in, and it just didn't happen for them. You just realize how lucky you were.
Yeah, let's talk about the hair as well, shall we? I think, you know, I don't know how much work went into that, but it used to come on stage on its own now. So how much lacquer and stuff did you put on it?
Well, you've noticed the ozone layer is recovered now after that. But I was, yeah, it was us. We were responsible, I think. And it was quite a thing, the hair. Yeah, I had someone specifically brought in to do the hair everywhere I went, yeah.
Was it always what you wanted? I mean, as a boy, I know originally I think you were born in Bristol. We spoke years ago, and but you basically a Suffolk boy, aren't you, from Ipswich or just outside? So, was it everything you wanted to be at school? Did you know what you wanted to do?
I was pretty sure from about sort of 14 or 15 onwards. Before that, I was going to be a movie star. Before that, I was going to be, a professional footballer or whatever. It's basically, I just want to be the center of attention. I think that was the, as long as it involved that.
But you were in a few bands, weren't you, to start with?
Yeah, I was just in the usual school bands, and I didn't play guitar at that time. I just kind of sung and threw a few poses. But yeah, early school bands, and then I had my own band when I was working at the unemployment benefit office in Ipswich, and then got lucky with a local band who kind of earned their living playing music. So I played professionally for about 3 years, just doing anything from bar mitzvahs, Jewish weddings, and anything that came along. And then yeah, got lucky with the MCA Records.
And afterwards, I mentioned, I mean, of course, you wrote One and Only for Chesney, but you've collaborated with all sorts of people since. And then you decided, maybe to go back and do some of your own music again. And I think the difference I detect in the stuff that's, on the new album is that in the early days, I don't think you really wrote music in any way about yourself, but maybe that's what you're doing now with, more life experience.
Yeah, I figured out it's kind of easier writing from your own perspective. I think I was just early on, I was just afraid of getting found out, really, because I didn't think there was anything that interesting about me that I should write about myself. So I just used to kind of write in the third person or write about things I'd read in the newspaper or seen on the TV and stuff like that. So, and it wasn't until at the end of the 90s I realized it was a lot easier just writing what you know, which is, and you know yourself. So that changed.
Does that make it easier now as a songwriter than it was back in the day?
Well, it gets harder for other reasons. It gets harder because you don't want to repeat yourself, and you kind of lose the ability to surprise yourself as well. That doesn't happen so often. So just the whole process takes a bit longer, I think. Yeah. And you don't have to panic when you dry up a bit every now and again.
What did it feel like to get back into Abbey Road Studios though? Because that's an amazing place to, it's, I mean, it just has an air of creativity in it, doesn't it?
It does. It's a special place, and it had, it was the scene of a previous crime to me as well, because we recorded the one and only there, which has in exactly the same studio, actually. So going back into that room felt really good.
Do you reckon everybody who goes, no matter how famous they are, does everybody have to have a photograph taken on the zebra crossing outside?
I don't actually have one yet,
Oh,
but yeah,
come on.
much to the annoyance of local taxi drivers. Yeah,
So,
that still happens a lot.
tell us about the new album then, and how long it took to write and so on, and when you decided, because I think it's 8 years, isn't it? When you decided, I'm going to do an album again.
Yeah, it was 8 years. I don't think it was it. I ever decide. I never decided I wasn't going to make another album. So it's just kind of a process of just messing about in a studio and going and playing the old game of golf and mowing the lawn and just kind of it was as I said, it was a slow process. And I guess in earnest, I was making it for about 3 years. I guess actually recording most of it at home. And if it wasn't until the sort of the last third of it that we actually got into Abbey Road. So it was, yeah, it was a quite a long process, but it was kind of, yeah, it was kind of weird. I never at any point knew I was making an album. I was just sort of making some, recording stuff because that's what I do. And eventually there was enough there, and I started playing it to people, and they thought, well, great, let's go.
And how different is the process now to the 1980s when you wrote all those hits? Is it different from songwriting right the way through to getting in the studio?
It is quite different, yeah, partly because of technology. I mean, beforehand, it was a really big deal. You booked a studio, you booked the engineer, you booked any musicians you were gonna use, and it was a big event actually going into the studio. But nowadays, because everybody's got some kind of setup at home, it's just a, it's a it's a slow it's a gradual process, and you could might record a vocal just before tea, and on your own, and just piece it together at home. So it's a more solitary experience certainly than it was back in the day.
And when you get into the studio, obviously you need, you know, the best, the finest string section, you know, great producers, mixers, and you need a great drummer. I mean, somebody like Mark Price might be a good idea. I don't know if he's on the album, is he?
He's not. Do you know Mark?
Mark lives down the road in Loughborough now, here in Leicestershire. And he was a drummer with you for, in fact, he was your drummer at Live Aid, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was my drummer for about 3 or 4 years, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but in the thick of it. Yeah.
He was in All About Eve as well, and Delamitri, I think.
Yeah.
So Live Aid, that whole experience, do you still have to pinch yourself now? Because, I mean, it's still available on DVD, you know, the box set and so on. Do you pinch yourself that you were there?
Yeah, well, I've seen it on YouTube. I know I was. That was definitely me. But it was a bizarre and special day. I think all of us have kind of felt very privileged to have had the chance to be there. But it was also terrifying, but that's besides the point. No, you're right. It was, you do pinch yourself sometimes. A lot of things that happened back in those days, you think, did that really happen? Was that me?
I guess at the time as well, because you were so heavily involved, and it was, you know, I wouldn't say it was thrown together because it was amazing, but it all happened pretty quickly. Maybe at the time, people didn't realise just how big it was.
No, it got very big very quickly. I think when Bob first asked me to do it back in January, it was just going to be a gig in London to follow up from the Band-Aid thing. And then, you know, when everybody thought, well, I don't know, Hammersmith Odeon, then it was Wembley Arena, then it was the stadium, then it was happening in Philadelphia as well, then it was televised around the world, and it just got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. But you're right, I mean, to a certain extent, it wasn't thrown together. There was a lot, as you said, but it was a lot of work went into it. But plenty of stuff was going wrong, left, right, and centre. I mean, for instance, the revolving stage, which was in three sections, there was people setting up, people breaking down, and people actually on stage. And it was supposed to revolve, and it didn't. So there were literally people underneath the stage just pushing it around every 20 minutes.
That's a claim for somebody, isn't it? I was the one who pushed the revolve round.
Yeah, well, there must be someone out there who did that.
Well, listen, the album is fantastic. It's available now, I think, isn't it? Certainly out this month, if it's not available now.
Yeah, it's out. It came out on Friday, yeah.
Fantastic. It's called Oxymoron. And we're going to finish with another track from the album. We heard She Gets Me. This is from Cloudy Bay to Malibu. Tell us a bit about this.
This is a song. this is basically a song about a fellow who loses his long-term girlfriend and decides to drown his sorrow by traveling around the world via the medium of alcoholic beverages, basically.
Okay. I won't ask you where the story comes from, and maybe that might be
embarrassing. No, it's not personal experience. I've never done it in one night, anyway.
Well, listen, it's been great talking to you. The album is absolutely fantastic. It's available now. It's called Oxymoron. Nick Kershaw, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Mark.
Cracking song. The album's cracking as well, actually. Oxymoron, the brand new offering after 8 years from Nick Kershaw.